Hello everyone, and welcome back to my Rusty RP-1 playthrough, where we are about to launch our Beluga Lunar-capable spacecraft on an LR-LR mission. It will rendezvous with the lander, and we will land on the moon. So, hang on, let's see who's trained. Yep, so it's going to be the station crew again, because I don't want to wait the extra time. So, the other crew are the backups for two flights. It will be Harold Chavez, Randy Campbell, and Rita Marshall. Rita Marshall will continue to be the mission commander if she has the most experience. Zoom out, target the moon. And we want to launch into the plane of the target. We're going to go even lower. That all looks correct. It will take us a day. Let's do it. Now we can look at the stack in all its glory. Go. Hey, Piano Josh. going to turn my RCS on for the third stage. Quite a little plume. Alright, so the abort tower is going to be jettisoned as soon as we stage because of the auto-staging logic in MechJib. But that's okay. Ah, we have an excellent amount of delta V remaining on that stage. Oh, I didn't get Lamont's latest. That fixes the flickering there, I think. But I didn't grab that before I started KSP. Oh well. This is sort of the reverse of Saturn V. Our second stage is decent. It's our third stage that has the insanely good mass ratio. Saturn V, the S4B was good, but not exceptional. And the S2 was a really high performance stage. I mean, to be fair, some of that was because the S4B had to have the instrument unit, and the S2 was literally just tanks and engines. But still, it was an insanely high performance stage. Hey, Ack. Hey, Pap. Why we have so much more delta V this time than the other time. Our drag losses can't be that much lower. 150 versus 160 shouldn't have made that much of a difference. It confuses me. I'll take it though, for sure. Yeah, I haven't moved to SSTU. I should try it, but I just, I don't know. I like what I got. Yeah, we'll probably run out of LH2 before we run out of LOX. I should over-provision it slightly based on actual propellant utilization. Yeah, so it had 30 extra liters of LOX. Brandon Enter. Pitch down commencing. All right, approaching insertion velocity. Perfect. All right. Now, I get to mess around with this to make a free return. So let's make it about 3200. That's not far off. That's about right. All right, and what kind of perisaline do we have? That's a big perisaline. Slow that puppy down. And that's a bit far off. And what does that do? That goes... That's actually pretty good, all things considered. Is that sticking? All right. That's really quite good. Correctable on RCS. I'm going to land. I'm doing an LOR mission. So... Brandonator, yes, they're gonna go say hi to the lander. So when is that? In 2 days and 16 hours. So they're actually gonna beat the lander. So let's do a slower transit, I guess. Which way do we want to go here? This way. Okay. Now what are we looking at? That was so nice before, but 3 days, 8 hours. I guess we should have waited another day. I told you we should have waited another day to launch. So we'll just... This is fine. This is fine. We'll go back to what we had before. Which I really liked. And we'll just orbit the moon a little bit first. That's fine. That's a little tight. $359 and all right. Alright, let's perform this maneuver. This will do. And how long until we moon periapsis? 2 days and 16 hours. So we'll have 16 hours to orbit the moon before the other thing arrives. Ah! Free return, so like technically we could have sent both of these things prograde, but I like to roleplay at least a little bit, and that means that we do a free return trajectory, and then we correct it to a closer trajectory once we've assured that everything works. And I've already sent the lander in retrograde, so we have to do retrograde to match it. So let's go to the node. interesting. You can no longer warp while attitude control is on, or it will kill persistent rotations rotation. And yeah, that's not a lot of us. Yes, for 38. Note, interestingly enough, that this right here is less mass than the Apollo lunar landing stack, let alone any S4B. But that's only to be expected, because we're chucking way less each time, and we're using hydrolox, as you can see. All right, so let's do this thing. TLI burn on the light side. Look at that boil off go. We have a lot of excess capacity in this, which is good. I was a little worried. I guess we could have stuck a bit more in here. But we have enough insulation that we haven't lost any of it yet, and that's cool. TLI burn, here we go. I mean, I'm using Hydrolox for the TLI as well. So, free return neither here nor there. It's just a transfer that takes more delta V than a minimal energy transfer would take you there faster. I mean, you could go fast prograde as well. You don't have to go retrograde to go fast. It just so happens that going retrograde around the moon takes a little tiny bit more delta V because you have to shoot out in front of the moon. So, by definition, it would be a hair faster. But yeah, I could do a 3147 meter per second transfer and still come in retrograde. And that's broadly what I did with the lander. That's why it's taking so long. I assume we overburned. Because we always overburn. Yes, we did. The difference from Apollo was that they launched to a fairly high perihelion for free return, and I'm trying, and then did a course correction that took them off a free return and to a low perihelion. But I'm going with a low perihelion that nonetheless will serve as a decent free return perihelion. Alright. So, we're going to let go of the TLI stage. Here we go. And we'll lower this a little further. Clear away from the booster. It's a handsome little Apollo. I don't have any skirt, and I'm only using two of these engines to save mass. All right, now. Why does it not have? That's so weird. Oh, because it's out of electric charge. Heh, that's why. Alright, so I'm going to give it a little bit of electric charge just so I can push it into the moon. Still on course. And look at that, comes sliding by. No, these are AJ10-133, sir. Basically, it's the pressure-fed hydrox variant of the AJ10. General Electric partnered with Aerojet for the D2 proposal. Brandon, the problem is that, so I click retrograde. So say I click prograde and I wanted to orient to prograde. Then mech jeb will burn for 2 seconds, which is what we have it set to do. And then it will coast for most of the rest of the rotation. If I then go into time warp to rotate faster, all my rotation stops because one of these modes is on. That's what annoys me. All right, we want to turn the fuel cells on, I think. Oh, we don't want to hit range safety. For sure. All right, so we want to drain out of this thing first. And so we have set it to be. All right, electric charge going back up because the fuel cells are working. All right, let's go to the moon. And we're going to reach it a good few hours before the lander does. Now, our free return is not so good. Because we had to correct it. So we actually did do the correction that took us off a free return and gave us a good periselene. But that's fine. I ain't scared. Historically on Apollo, they would do it out like about here or so. Yes, it's very good that Mike added the confirmation dialogue for range safety. Anyway, let's go ahead and warp to here. Oh, I didn't actually group my ladders on the lander. I'll have to manually deploy them. but that's fine. Alright, so now this is going to be fun. We want to change apoapsis. Alright, and we want to focus on the moon. Now, the interesting thing here is we know we want to be back here in... So, we know this is in 9 hours and 19 minutes. So call it 23 hours versus 9 hours. So we need an orbit that has a period of 14 hours. Which means, well, slightly more than 14 hours. 14 hours and like 2 minutes. So we need this to be 7 hours and 1 minute ahead of the perihelion. Hi Dingbat. Yeah, I wrote most of the stuff here. Most of the stuff. Like, I didn't write the stuff you see on the screen, because this is Kerbal Alarm Clock and this is Mech Jeb. But I wrote Real Solar System and Realism Overhaul and did a bunch on Real Fuels and RP-0, which is now RP-1, and I don't even remember how many mods I made. A lot of mods. And also KSP itself. I have a good chunk of code in KSP itself. Alright, so I was saying, so this needs to be 7 hours and 1 minute past... Oops, wrong way. So if this is now 9 hours and 18 minutes, that needs to be 16 hours and 18 minutes. Which may or may not be possible. What if we did two orb? Yeah, we don't want that big a burn. So we actually want to do it over two orbits. And I said it was 14 hours and 2 minutes. Sounds about right. So 3.5 hours, so 3 hours and 30 minutes and 30 seconds. That fits together pretty well. So 12 hours, 46 minutes, 47 minutes. That's close. I think this will work. All right, let's hope my math is correct. Oh, there's 3 minute difference. So, well, we'll be like 30 seconds off. Pap, no, they didn't do anything this silly. They did not, and I'm only doing it this way because we launched these things so close together that it makes sense. Otherwise, one of them would be in a parking orbit, the other would arrive, set up a phasing orbit, and then It's just that we know it's going to be in a given position at a given time. Except, shoot, what am I doing? This is stupid. It's not going to be there then. At all. It's going to be somewhere else then. The moon is going to be further over. It's going to be, like, there then. But, whatever. It'll be fairly close, I think. It will be fairly close. We'll at least be in the same plane. What I'd like to know, but I have no way of... Ooh, I get it. Oh, I will get a closest... Heh, sweet. Intersect 1, where's... Oh, let's just go ahead and let it cross the SOI. Now, yes, it's over there. Oh, I guessed wrong which way it was going to change for the periselene. So /114. This is 93. So let's play with this a little bit. Oh, it's not in a closed orbit, so we don't know where it's... Of course. Right. So let's just... So we'll just circularize off this. And we'll rendezvous with the lander. So much for my smarts. But it'll all be fine. In particular... So 968 is quite expensive as circularization goes. So we definitely need to do as many maneuvers as possible off the lander. This thing will just barely have enough. Propellant. To do what it needs to do. In fact... We're going to raise this up to 100. Yeah, this is going to be tight. But we still have some reserved NTO and MMH. And we can even transfer some across from the lander. Happily, our ejection burn should only be about 700 and something. Maybe 750. Captured? Probably should have captured to elliptical orbit, saved a little delta V, but if one becomes circular, it'll make the rendezvous easier. But sure and certain we're going to do rendezvous off the other thing. There's no way we have the delta V to do rendezvous on this. Really should have packed some extra LH2 and LOX. Looks like we could save about 60 kilograms by dumping wastewater over the side. There's the moon. No cosine losses, we expect to have 874 meters per second left after this burn. We'll see what we actually have. Rather less than that. Meters per second less than that. Alright, so we'll get perfectly stable to aid in rendezvous. See how much it costs to go home. Alright, so we have a little bit of a margin, most of which we'll use up on the departure burn. Because it will be more like 800. So we have like a 40 meter per second margin. However, we need to save some of that LH2 and LOX to power the fuel cells on the way home. So we'll see how that works. this thing. Oh, we're in luck. I can transfer some of the locks in LH2 over. Oh, that's good. I think we can do that. Well, the decoupler doesn't have crossfeed, but it can, I think, be changed to have crossfeed. Maybe in flight, I don't know. Anyway, actually, you know what? Let's focus on the moon and target that. Relative inclination 0.61. That sucks. That sucks. I thought we wouldn't have any relative inclination. Oh well. Our separation is 400 kilometers when we insert. So that means annoyingly. Oh, we actually, no, it's fine. We'll have a slightly higher period. Target position. No, we'll fall further behind. Shoot. We somehow need a lower period. All right, so we'll create that node. Yeah, I guess we should have done a slower transfer with the other thing. It would have saved a bunch of delta V. This is only 794. And the other was 900 and something. So. Wow. Alright. Let's try to fix the planes as well. That's worse. That's pretty good. That node, let's see when that node is. It's cheap, but how far in the future is it? Yeah, no. So I think what we want to do So I think we want to do that, and then we need... That'll put right, and then intersect 2 is even closer together, and then we can burn to, yeah, so we'll do that. All right, that's cool. We have a plan. Wait, why does that say local control? That is deeply, deeply odd. Isn't anyone aboard this thing? I know that much. Yeah, I'm fine with the Karman line being something you either need a V2 or need to tech up for. That was surprisingly light on the steering losses. All right, now... Two hours and 51 minutes, we have a 9 meter per second burn, and there we are. Thank you. So far, so good. How are these things doing? They don't have much RCS left. No! We screwed up our orbit enough that... Huh? What is going on? That's so weird. I made no change. And okay, whatever. That's super weird. All right. So we're going to manually warp to that maneuver and then burn it. Blowfish, yeah, that's exactly how Module Engine Config works. It creates a new config node and tells module engines to load it. And it works fine. So Pap, like I was saying, look at how Sound and Fury's procedural engines mod actually works. Why are we drifting off? Oh, because we're out of RCS propellant, that's why. Right. All right, where should manifest? MMH. Okay. NTO. Okay. Pap, you shouldn't have to do that. Why are we rolling? That's super weird. Anyway, let's fix on the node. All you should do is actually deal with the config nodes that Module Engine Configs has and clobber their thrust curves with yours, and then just tell Module Engine Configs to reload config. Actually, I guess we should. I guess we need to execute it with the RL10. Okay. How we doing? All right. Oh, look. We're gonna rendezvous on the dark side. How nice is that? Great. And nobody brought lights. All right. That's fine. It is what it is. And we can spare a bunch of locks in LH2. For the capsule, because we really only need about 2 km/s in this thing, at most. So we want about 2400 in the ascent stage to handle rendezvous docking as well as ascent. It'll probably be about 1.8 km/s to ascend, which means we need 200 meters per second on top of this. 200-300. At least 400, take 200 to land. Yeah, so we can give it some locks in LH2. Alright. Let's now go ahead and match the closest approach, which is in 56 minutes. Does that have a spin? Super weird. Okay. I guess we just need to use some upper stage propellant. Oh, there we go. Meters. Balanced RCS. So great. almost on the light side. No, we're not. We're only about 2/3 of the way through. And now we're going to get some light. Excellent. So, now let's go ahead and dock with this thing. So where is our target? Well, we're supposedly only 50 meters away, and I'm not seeing nothing. We know the sun was shining on the front of it. Kill our relative velocity. Ah, there's target minus, which means it must be somewhere. There it is. Bingo. All right. Actually, you know what? Let's still control from here. Because the axes are the same, it doesn't actually matter. What is with the RCS having a roll moment? So weird. All right. So the RCS is broadly balanced. Locked. Okay. think. I always forget to install Navy Fish's stocking thing. What the heck is SAS doing? Why is our relative velocity so darn high? I guess we've backed away to a safe distance. Let's kill our relative velocity. We know we need to come up some, so we'll just aim right at the thing. (sighs) 30 centimeters a second. Why not? Doing with roll. Alright. God, SAS is the worst. Okay. So. Step one, let's come right to a line. We'll slow down a little bit. Oops, sorry about that. Oh, we still have plenty of NTO and OMH. All right, almost parallel in this axis. Yeah. All right, now let's check out. We're not good in this axis. So we'll pitch up a little bit. And we'll come down. And come over. Come down. And kill off relative this axis. How are we doing vertically? Vertically, we seem like almost worse than before, which is weird. There we go. Now we're realigning. Okay, that only just took forever, but left a little bit. That's pretty good. Now, how are we? We need to pitch up a little bit. Okay. Realign. Fizz warp a little bit. Okay, vertical alignment is fixed. Horizontal alignment is pretty good. Bingo. Docked. Sweet. All right. So that was a trying experience. But that's okay. So let's open the hatches. And transfer some crew over. All right, something is weird with connected living space. Because... Great. I'm going to have to do a freaking EVA. That's beyond weird. So, there's something super weird about why those things aren't actually working for transfer. But before I do that, let me transfer over a little bit of locks. And a little bit of LH2. Hopefully, I'm making the right call here on how much. All right. So, I think I'm going to take a break here. So thanks everybody for watching, and I'll see you again soon when I actually land on the moon. Probably be later tonight, but we'll see. All right. Thanks everybody. Bye-bye.